A few years back, I shared with you how I automate my greenhouse as well as set up my irrigation system. Now things have moved on quite a bit since then. We've moved to a new property. I have a few more greenhouses and I've had to install the system multiple times since that original video. Now every time I do an installation, I make modifications and improvements from things I've learned, and of course I'm going to pass those things on to you. I thought I'd take the opportunity while I set up the new greenhouse. I'm going to show you how I set that up for irrigation as well as automation, and hopefully it gives you some tips and hints on how you can set up your own one. One thing that's been pretty constant every time I built a system is I've had an indoor reservoir like this black tank over here, and an outdoor reservoir, which in this case I have some interconnected IBCs, and they collect rainwater from the roof of my greenhouses. Now, why do I do that? It's the same reason I've given in the last video, and that is because by having this tank over here, I'm able to mix in my nutrients and I can control when I'm going to feed my plants without having to mix in small batches each time. That gives me options because it means I can water from my external tanks, and if I choose to feed, I can switch over to my internal tank. This here is probably the most important part of the system. If you are running drippers especially, make sure you have good filters. And I've used a few different filters over the years. Mesh filters are very cheap and easy to get hold of, but I find that the best ones to use are disc filters like these. So I'm just gonna switch this off on the incoming and you can have a look inside here. That is a disc filter. So it's these little red discs that fit in here. It really does not allow anything bad to go through the system. And yeah, it's quite easy to clean as well. This actually probably needs a bit of a clean. You can see some dirt in there. We'll do that after this video. But if you keep your water that's going in and going out nice and clean, then you shouldn't have too many problems with drippers. This here is the start of my automation. This is a valve that controls the output of water going into this tank. That serves two purposes. One is obvious, filling up the tank. So if I switch over the three-way valve that's down there to having incoming water from outside, then that means I can fill up this tank with clean rainwater. If I switch this three-way valve over so that its incoming water is from this tank, that means that when I add nutrients to this tank, if I switch on that valve, that means that it's going to circulate the water throughout the tank and it mixes up the nutrients perfectly. Let's talk about pumps for a bit. Now, when you're doing irrigation using drippers, you need to make sure that you're using a pump that doesn't push out too much pressure and too little flow. The cheaper pumps typically will have very little flow, but very, very high pressure. The cheap Chinese ones typically are like 100 PSI, which will just blow the drippers off the system. This is the pump that I have been using. It is the FL43. It puts out 40 PSI, which I think is a little bit too much for dripper systems, but otherwise it's a decent pump. What I was doing was splitting the output so that some water went back into the tank while the rest went into the drippers, and that allowed me then to control the pressure a little bit. This is an on-demand pump, so it has a little pressure switch down here. As soon as you turn on the tap, then the pump switches on. So that's exactly what you need if you're going to control things using relays and valves, which I'll show you in just a second. That's the biggest change I've made this year, is switching over to a single pump rather than four different pumps. That means I only have to maintain one pump and maintain one set of filters down here. And that's going to make life a lot easier at the end and the beginning of each season. Now, the other really cool thing with this specific pump is it is variable drive, so the motor can actually spin up and down depending on your requirements. I can set the PSI on this, the pressure, so that it's absolutely perfect for my drippers, and that is working brilliantly. The flow rate is fantastic, and yeah, it just works really, really well. One of the other benefits of having this system in place is that I was able to fit taps that are coming off my IBCs. So those taps are using rainwater straight off that pump, and the pressure is fantastic. I can run sprayers off of it into my raised beds over there, and it just works brilliantly, rather than using tap water, which especially in our region is terrible. Let's get inside the greenhouse and let's go step by step installing the irrigation system. These slotted channels are excellent for mounting things in your greenhouse. An electrician friend of mine introduced me to them, and I use them all the time now.
In my previous installation, I used solar power and 12 volts. However, it would work out too expensive to do that with the new layout, so I am using mains power. There is a much higher voltage drop when running 12 volt DC over any sort of distance compared to 220 volts AC or 110 volts AC, which means I would likely have to set up a solar panel and battery for each grow location. So AC makes more sense in this scenario. If you are burying cable runs, use armored cable to avoid accidents in the future. And make sure you use the correct gauge wire for the length of cable that you're using. There are plenty of calculators online to work this out. I would also recommend checking with your local regulations regarding these types of installations. If you don't feel comfortable working with mains voltage, please speak to an expert to get these plugs installed. A fan is essential. It'll keep the air fresh around your plants, keeping them healthy. It'll reduce pockets of hot and cold in the grow space. It'll help with pollination later in your season, and it will help strengthen the stems of your young plants with some movement. Let's move on to setting up the irrigation. Lay out your pots or sources, like I'm doing here, to get an idea of where your plants will be. This will allow you to set up where the pipes and fittings will go. I would recommend getting a cheap pipe cutter to make your cuts. It makes things a lot neater. To make pipe fitting easier, get a flask of hot water to soften and wet the pipe before inserting the fittings. This will save you so much time. You can see I fitted some valves. I will talk a bit more about these a little later. They are inexpensive but work fantastically, and I haven't had a single failure in years. My main line is 13mm or 1/2 inch HDPE pipe, and the dripper line is 4mm or 1/8 inch pipe. I like to be able to isolate segments of my irrigation with a tap. This allows you to be selective about how much of your grow space you're using, and it also helps with maintenance in the beginning and the end of your season. I have used many different drippers over the years before settling on these ones, and they are my absolute favorite. There are two reasons. They are pressure compensated drippers, so you'll get the same output regardless of whether the dripper is at the beginning or the end of the line. The second reason is that they are serviceable. You can open them up and clean them very easily, which makes maintenance at the beginning and end of the season very simple.
Before I install my automation system, let me explain basically how these work. They are very simple devices. They essentially are taps. They allow water through or they don't. This version is a normally closed version, which means that if we don't apply power, then it's closed. If we apply power, then it'll open up. This version is a 220 mains voltage, and you can get 12 volts as well if you are running that. The way I have it set up at the moment, just for demonstration, is just using a normal light switch. If I switch this on, it's connected to the mains voltage. You can hear it starting to water, and you can see down there the drippers are running. If I turn it off, there you go, it'll switch off the valve and it'll stop dripping. That's essentially how it works. And all we're doing with automation is turning those on or off. This here is my automation system. I will be doing a video on my second channel showing you your getting put together, and it's gone through a few iterations, but I'm pretty happy with this one. It allows you to have six outputs, so six devices you can control. It has multiple areas for sensors, so you can have many different sensors. I have on here just temperature, humidity, and air pressure, as well as another temperature gauge. I also have, well, a display and a real-time clock, which is helpful for scheduling. So yeah, it's a good old system and it works really well. It's an iteration of the one that I had in my original video, just a little bit more advanced, and yeah, it works fantastically. But I'll show that to you on a video on my second channel as soon as I've finished editing that one. It is done. I just need to get it finished editing. I've been working on the system for a while, not only this here, the actual device. I've been testing it for the last 2.5-3 years and it's working very, very nicely. But I've also built a server on the back end that's sitting on one of my web servers, so I can get all the readings off this, as well as set schedules and do some other clever stuff. And that will actually be going public very soon. Quite a bit of it is going to be free to use, and I'm going to show you how to connect to it with very inexpensive devices. Or I'm thinking of maybe doing something with this board, letting other people actually use it themselves. But I'm still thinking about all that. I have to think about the liability side of it and the legalities. But let's add a schedule here and just make sure that the the valves actually turning on. It's essentially exactly what we did before with just switching a switch, except now we're switching a switch using this device. And there we go, V1, V2. And let's take a look at the drippers. I hope you found this video interesting and you learned a few things. Remember that on my second channel, I will be doing a bit of a deep dive into the design of this PCB that I showed you earlier, as well as all the coding that goes behind it to make this thing actually work in all the different greenhouses. So keep an eye out on that. Go and subscribe to ChiliChump2. That's youtube.com/ChiliChump2. I also have a beginner's guide series on that channel, which shows you from beginning to end how to set up your own automation. It doesn't have to be as complex as what I've showed you today. You can keep it very simple, just, you know, activate a single valve on a timed basis, like once every 2 days or whatever. You can set that up in no time at all. In a couple hours, you'd be able to do something like that. Even if you've never touched any coding before or any sort of electrical engineering, I'm sure that by about 2 hours, you'd be up and running, no problem at all. If you have any questions, let me know in the comments down below. I'll do my best to answer. And until the next video, thank you so much for watching and stay spicy.